Good afternoon. Welcome to St. Francis. Please rise and join in singing our entrance hymn number 517.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of Almighty God, and the love of Almighty God, and the peace of... I think I need to start over again. The Lord be with you. And my brothers and sisters, now that I got your attention, we come together to celebrate. To celebrate God's gift of the call that we have, the call that we have to be his disciples, to let go of whatever it may be that is that obstacle, is that barrier of following Christ. It may be good things, it may be things that are sinful, but nevertheless we are called to give of our lives, deny ourselves, to follow him. And Jesus leads us to everlasting life, so let us turn to him now as we ask forgiveness for our sins. Lord Jesus, you steadfastly move toward Jerusalem. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you called your disciples to follow you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you warn them of distractions and demands. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill.
Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first book of Kings. The Lord said to Elijah, "You shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, and Abba Meholah, as prophet to succeed you." Elijah set out and came upon Elisha, son of Shaphat, as he was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen. He was following the 12th. Elijah went over to him and threw his cloak over him. Elisha left the oxen, ran to Elijah, and said, "Please let me kiss my father and mother goodbye, and I will follow you." Elijah answered, "Go back. I have done anything to you." Elisha left him, and taking the yoke of oxen, slaughtered them. He used the plowing equipment for fuel to burn their flesh, and gave it to his people to eat. Then Elisha left and followed Elijah as his attendant. The word of the Lord.
You are my God, O Lord. it is you who are my portion and cup, you yourself who secure my lot. You are my inheritance, O Lord, O Lord, tu eres Señor, el loto de mi heredad. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel, who even at night directs my heart. I keep the Lord before me always. With him at my right hand, I shall not be moved. You are my inheritance, O Lord, O Lord. Tu eres Señor, el loto de mi heredad. And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad, even my flesh shall rest in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to hell, nor let your Holy One see corruption. You are my inheritance, O Lord, O Lord, to of joy in your presence. At your right hand, bliss forever. You are my inheritance, O Lord, O Lord. Tu eres Señor, el loto de mi
Lectura de la carta del apóstol San Pablo a los Gálatas. Hermanos, Cristo nos ha liberado para que seamos libres. Conserven pues la libertad y no se sometan de nuevo al yugo de la esclavitud. Su vocación, hermanos, es la libertad. Pero cuiden de no tomarla como pretexto para satisfacer su egoísmo. Antes bien, háganse servidores los unos de los otros por amor. Porque toda la ley se resume en un solo precepto: amarás a tu prójimo como a ti mismo. Pues si ustedes se muerden y devoran mutuamente, acabarán por destruirse. Los exhorto, pues, a que vivan de acuerdo con las exigencias del Espíritu. Así no se dejarán arrastrar por el desorden egoísta del hombre. Este desorden está en contra del Espíritu de Dios. Y el espíritu está en contra de ese desorden. Y esta oposición es tan radical que les impide a ustedes hacer lo que quieren hacer. Pero si los guía el espíritu, ya no están ustedes bajo el dominio de la ley. palabra de Dios.
From the Holy Gospel according to Luke. When the days for Jesus being taken up were fulfilled, he resolutely determined to journey to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On the way, they entered a Samaritan village to prepare for his reception there. But they would not welcome him, because the destination of his journey was Jerusalem. When the disciples, James and John, saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to consume them?" Jesus turned and rebuked them, and they journeyed to another village. As they were proceeding on their journey, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus answered him, "Foxes have dens, and birds of the skies have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to rest his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he replied, "Lord, let me go first and bury my father." He answered him, Let the dead bury their dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." And another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me say farewell to my family at home." To him Jesus said, "No one who sets a hand to the plow and looks to what is left behind is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So often in our journeys of faith, we have moments when we've been called, we really feel that closeness, that connection with God. It can be after retreat. It can be after perhaps a new experience where we've done something where we've gone beyond our comfort zone. We've entered into a new ministry. We've reached out to somebody that maybe ordinarily we wouldn't have reached out to. We did the hard work of making reconciliation happen. Or maybe we just worked against sometimes that simmering laziness that can be within us, that convinces us not to change, not to do anything differently in our lives. And so those moments when we can overcome those obstacles, those barriers, there's a sense of satisfaction. There's something good that we felt that we've accomplished. In following Jesus, That's part of the consolation. That's part of the gift of the grace that he gives us as we follow him. I think we've all experienced in different ways. But if you're like me, you like to stay with that experience. Kind of ride that wave for a little while to see where it takes us. Forgetting that we got to continue to do that work of conversion. We have to continue to answer that call. In Luke's gospel, it's very clear what Jesus is doing. This is a turning point of the gospel, what we hear today. And that turning point comes right after what we heard last week, where Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And thanks to Simon Peter, he got it right. You're the Messiah. Then reminding Simon of the conditions of discipleship, and they were all scandalized. Jesus then shows them what this means. Let us go to Jerusalem. Let us, in a sense, make a radical decision that we are now changing the aspect of this mission that God has given to us. Jesus and his disciples. He was resolutely determined, the gospel says. The older traditions, it said that Jesus set his face like flint towards Jerusalem. What was going on before? Nothing wrong, nothing but good. Jesus was answering that call to ministry, obedient to his Father, preaching and teaching and healing all around the area of Galilee, the area that he was from, the people that he knew, the areas that he was familiar with, as well as his disciples. Things are going great. The disciples thought, other than this little miscue of not understanding what this messiahship of Jesus meant, they were feeling good about themselves. They were satisfied. And then Jesus says, "We must go to Jerusalem." They had no idea what that meant. And along the way, what kind of obstacles did they come across? We must remember now, what is in Jerusalem? Where Jesus would suffer and die and rise again to save us. Jesus knew what he was getting into. His disciples didn't. So even this journey from Galilee to Jerusalem, is significant of what our journeys and their journeys are all about. Taking up the cross and following Jesus isn't easy in the practical, everyday life that we have. I don't know about you, it's easy to say, "Yes, Lord, I will follow you wherever you go," just like the gentleman in the gospel. "Oh, yes, Lord, I will do my best to forgive. I will do my best to work for peace. I will do my best to take up that cross that I have." The disciples said that, then what did they encounter? First of all, they encountered rejection, hatred. They encountered being judged because of who they were by their ethnicity and their religion. The Jewish people and the Samaritans just didn't get along. For various reasons, we don't need to go into that. But it was based on prejudices, based on religion, based on ethnicity. They hated each other, and they justified their hatred. They justified the way to stay apart. And most Jews of the day would walk around Samaria, so they didn't have to face that hostility. Jesus doesn't avoid it. He heads right into the hostility, because this is not acceptable. This is not part of the kingdom of God. And so the answer the apostles, when they were faced with that rejection, that hatred, that prejudice, was our normal default, our normal reaction. Well, let's take hatred with more hatred. Let's take violence with more violence, rejection with more rejection. Does that get us into the kingdom? Does that help us to understand the way of the cross, the way of following Christ? Not at all. Jesus rebuked James and John, the sons of thunder. This is not the way to Jerusalem. This is not the way to your salvation. It doesn't matter if everybody thinks that this is okay. It doesn't matter if you have 1,000 reasons to justify. It's not okay. We must go on to the next village. So Jesus did. So they faced that rejection. Jesus also talked about the desire that we all have to stay in our status quo, That desire that we look for comfort, for security, and all of those things are good, necessary. But yet, when we follow him, those things at times necessarily need to go. If we're all about our comfort zone, if we're all about trying to fit our religion, our discipleship, our call to follow Christ, our call to imitate his love in our lives, that's going to take us out of our comfort zones. The gospel isn't the gospel if it doesn't challenge us to think in a new way, to feel in a new way, and to act in a new way. If we instead try to fit, as those disciples were naturally doing, and we all do it, try to fit the gospel, try to fit the truth of our religion into what we already believe, what we already think, what we already are accustomed to acting, it's no longer the gospel. We're missing the power of the gospel. We're missing the call to conversion that it has in our lives as missionaries of Christ. And so they had to challenge that, their desire to look for comfort, to look for security, to even to do those things that are priorities, those family obligations that they have. Jesus is saying they're not unimportant, but are you willing to even let those priorities to be shaken up, to be turned on their head in order to follow me? In order to put your family connections, the priorities for your life, your plans for yourself, for your families, for your children, to allow that to be even within this kingdom, even within this discipleship. Are you willing to be as obedient to the will of your Father in heaven as Jesus is? That's a radical call. And often we don't see it, we don't feel it until there's something in our lives that puts that in front of our faces, that calls us to make that radical decision, to set our faces like flint towards Jerusalem, to be willing to let go of those things that we always thought were most important. But when we let the Word of God into our minds and into our hearts, it challenges us to think and to act in a new way. But we'll never hear that message. We'll never hear that message if we don't spend some time to let that Word of God sink in. If we don't spend some time to put aside those things that normally take up our focus, to take up our attention, to take up our preoccupation with the things that we have to do, the things that we have to accomplish, the things that we so often are much more willing to immediately give our attention to our cell phones that are alerting us that somebody has sent us a message, or whatever it may be, or the desire that we have to complete the show on Netflix, or this one more activity that we have to get in. And then we let the things of the kingdom of God be put to the side. So what Jesus is saying, this call of discipleship, this call to be his missionaries in the world, to proclaim that kingdom of God that is among us, that we're called to live and show forth in our action, that takes precedence. Everything else needs to fit into this. The decision that Jesus made, he left some good things behind. He left the life that he knew in Galilee, the comfort that he knew there, the familiarity behind, so he could go to Jerusalem, to take up suffering, to take up death. Are we willing to leave certain things behind, those things that can distract us, those things that can maybe get in the way of truly listening to that message? Our own default reactions when it comes to situations that challenge us that we don't like, especially those situations of hatred and conflict in our world. When somebody disagrees with us powerfully, so how do we react to that? What Jesus is saying is when we look ahead and we're plowing, it means those things that we hold on to. And so often there's things of the past hurts, or just things that make us angry and upset and conflicts. We hold on to them, our resentments. Until we can let go of those, and allow ourselves to think and act and believe in a new way. In this kingdom that Christ is bringing us to us today that we celebrate here at the Eucharist. That is what will allow us to live in those words that St. Paul reminds us in Galatians. That we were freed for what? We were freed to be free, for freedom's sake. To be free to live in obedience to God, to do his will and not our own. That is how the kingdom of God becomes a reality in our lives and our world. Let us heed that call. Let us allow that call to change our ways of seeing and of thinking and of acting. Together united in our faith and in our call to be missionary disciples, let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My friends, as we struggle to be faithful to our calling, let us pray for ourselves and for the many needs of people throughout the world.
For the church, that we may stay faithful to the challenging call of discipleship, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who work for and promote peace and true security across the world, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who serve the victims of war, for international, medical, emergency relief, and human rights organizations, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the ability to resist the many cultural distractions that call us to physical comfort, financial success, and status, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For families and young people recreating during these summer months and those who cannot afford recreation, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace to guide our children as they face difficult choices in life, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the environment, and especially for those in places in the world suffering from drought or flooding, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, the suffering, and the dying in this community, and for those who have died, including Erna Fogarty, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. God who guides us, let us not forget that you are with us as we struggle on our journey with Jesus. Help us to focus on what is most important and allay our confusion, doubts, and fears. We pray in the name of him who beckons us to follow and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name. Our Lord,
Señor Dios, que bondadosamente realizas el fruto de tus sacramentos, concédenos que seamos capaces de servirte como corresponde a tan santos misterios, por Jesucristo nuestro Señor.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift
them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, creator of the world and source of all life. For you never forsake the works of your wisdom, but by your providence are even now at work in our midst. With mighty hand and outstretched arm, you led your people Israel through the desert. Now, as your church makes her pilgrim journey in the world, you always accompany her by the power of the Holy Spirit and lead her along the path of time to the eternal joy of your kingdom through Christ our Lord. And so with the angels and saints, we too sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race, and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst, and when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the nights before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Por eso, Padre Santo, a celebrar el memorial de Cristo, tu Hijo nuestro Salvador, y que condujiste por su pasión y muerte en cruz, a la gloria de la resurrección, y lo sentaste a tu derecha. Anunciamos la obra de tu amor hasta que Él venga, y te ofrecemos el pan de vida y el cáliz de bendición. Mira con bondad la ofrenda de tu iglesia, en la que se hace presente el sacrificio pascual de Cristo, que se nos ha confiado, y concédenos por la fuerza del Espíritu de tu amor, ser contados, ahora y por siempre, entre el número de los miembros de tu Hijo, cuyo cuerpo y sangre comulgamos. And so, having called us to your table, Lord, confirm in us unity, so that together with Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and your entire people, as we walk your ways with faith and hope, we may strive to bring joy and trust into the world. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face and in the resurrection. Give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the apostles and martyrs, with St. Francis de Sales, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Señor Jesucristo, que dijiste a tus apóstoles, la paz les dejo, mi paz les doy. No tengas en cuenta nuestros pecados, sino la fe de tu iglesia. Y conforme a tu palabra, concédele la paz y la unidad, tú que vives y reinas por los siglos de los siglos.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Este es el Cordero de Dios, que quita los pecados del mundo. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, not worthy should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And please be seated for our announcements.
If you are considering enrolling your child at Corpus Christi School in the fall, please visit their table in the gathering space after Mass. Prayer candles to support our pilgrims participating in World Youth Day next month are available in the gathering space. This Tuesday's Holy Hour will be offered for religious liberty. Join us in the chapel at 7 p.m. And please be sure to pick up a bulletin for more information on these and other important activities going on in the parish.
I'd also like you to remember in your prayers some parishioners who have recently passed away in our parish. One is Manuel Soto, whose funeral we'll be celebrating this coming week from today, on Saturday afternoon. And then also for a son of parishioners that are here, his name is Matthew Martinez, who died in an accident last week and in Fenville. His parents are Chino and Sulema Martinez, who are very involved in our parish. So his funeral was yesterday. Just ask for your special prayers for him and the family that truly grieves his loss so much. And please stand as we ask for God's blessing.
The Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.